It is another edition of the Daily Grossi. Chris Holdak and our Browns analyst Tony Grossi alongside me. Tone, the week has concluded here, and no offensive coordinator has been hired for the Browns. What is the latest, as there were more interviews on Friday?
Well, today, on Friday, they interviewed Kellen Moore, former Dallas Cowboys and L.A. Chargers offensive coordinator, who has the most experience of any of the Browns candidates in calling plays. He's done it for 5 years, four with Dallas and this past year with the Chargers. He was the fifth candidate interviewed by Kevin Stefanski and the Browns. The others are Andy Dickerson, Ken Dorsey, Gerard Johnson of the Houston Texans, and Brian Johnson of the Philadelphia Eagles, formerly of the Eagles. So five candidates. Chris, I know that the Browns have not requested any candidate who is involved in this weekend's championship games. So whether or not this concludes their search or they expand it into next week, we'll have to just wait and see. Right now, five candidates and no apparent news coming from Berea.
So a couple of things off of that. Does the timing, because I know in the past, and I'm not totally familiar of what the rule is, but do you have to wait to interview any of the coaches that are still actively in the postseason?
Yeah, you would have requested them by now, for one thing.
Okay.
You could have done a Zoom interview following the divisional playoff round, and then you could have done an in-person interview prior to the Super Bowl week. But we know the Browns, or I've learned that the Browns have not requested anybody involved in the playoffs. So that let's cross Clint Kubiak off the list. The
same go past. Let me just throw a wrinkle in that. In theory, couldn't they say, okay, Clint Kubiak loses this weekend, let's just go do the in-person interview Monday or Tuesday, right? Or when, like...
It's possible, sure.
Okay.
It would be unusual, because if they really wanted to interview him, they would have done the Zoom interview by now, the first interview, when they had the opportunity. But yeah, sure. Any of the two teams that drop off this weekend, anybody on their staffs are free to interview.
Yeah. Now, Tone, I'm not reporting anything, but it felt like out of all of the interviews that the Browns have done for the offensive coordinator position job, it felt like Kellen Moore seemed to have the most traction of, hey, when this guy's in Berea, don't let him leave without a contract, because if he does, he'll probably go get an interview elsewhere and get hired. Is that a fair vibe that you got? That's kind of what it felt like Twitter Nation today a little bit.
At some point today, I felt that. And yet the day came and went without any offer being made or any hire. Kellen Moore previously interviewed, I believe, with the Eagles before he came to Cleveland. Gerard Johnson, the Houston Texans quarterback coach, has probably done about five interviews for coordinator, including the Pittsburgh Steelers and Eagles and others. So there's still two head coaching jobs to be filled, and those head coaches will also need offensive coordinators. So there seems to be a lot of uncertainty on this hire right now.
All right, Tone, are the Browns, are they doing their due diligence by casting the wide net and interviewing a handful of people, or are they being indecisive?
I always thought, Chris, at the beginning of this process that Kevin Stefanski had somebody in mind. And that's why he fired Alex Van Pelt abruptly after the season. And yet it doesn't appear that way right now. Whoever that person is in mind, either they can't make a call on or they haven't interviewed yet. So I'm a little surprised it's gone this long, to be honest with you. I thought it would have been concluded by today, Friday, and a name would have surfaced as the next coordinator of the Browns, but that's not the case as of this recording. Still time left in the day.
Still time.
Yeah.
Now, you avoided the lasso of truth on the Really Big Show, and you just avoided my question. Due diligence or indecisiveness?
I think it's more due diligence.
Okay.
You know, there's still the question, is Kevin longing to find a guy he can trust to call the plays, or would he be fine with a guy, an inexperienced play caller, and just Kevin continue to do it in the next season at least? And maybe he's wrestling with that, you know, that decision too, because clearly some of the candidates he's interviewed, I don't know if he would trust them to turn over play calling to.
Sure.
There's only been two really with experience calling plays, Ken Dorsey and Kellen Moore. The others have not done it.
Yeah. Now, I wanted to just specifically on Moore. I was just looking again because it felt like for a moment there today, maybe it could have happened. And it, again, still might. But in his four seasons with Dallas as the offensive coordinator and calling plays, the Cowboys ranked second in points per game and net offensive yards per game. And keep in mind, a handful of those games, Dak Prescott was out with injury with that ankle, that broken ankle. So those are impressive numbers.
Yeah.
You know, do with it what you will. I know some people are skeptical of Kellen Moore because, in essence, after leaving the Chargers, he's gotten fired twice in two years. So
now, don't forget, I think Mike McCarthy inherited Kellen Moore. And then after their 2022 season, McCarthy changed coordinators. It was kind of a mutual parting. And Mike expressed some public comments about he was unsatisfied with the running game. He wanted to run the ball more. And that was one of the criticisms of Kellen Moore's, although they were very productive in at least three of those 4 years he was there. The running game was not the strength of the team. So he went to the Chargers, and lo and behold, they had an injury to Justin Herbert in week 11.
Yeah.
But their running game was virtually non-existent. So, you know, that to me would be a big question mark about his he brought him in. It's a different game here in the AFC North than it is in the AT&T Stadium or in the West Coast there. So we'll see how that goes. But I know there was a period of time during today on Friday where it looked like he might be the next coordinator, or at least it sounded that way.
Well, and it's funny, you know, Browns fans already, Tony, as you well know, clamor every Sunday, run the ball, run the ball. Mm-hmm. I don't know if Kellen Moore would necessarily fit that description.
But you know what? I mean, Kevin has made this, created this search to get new ideas into the offense. Well,
And I'm glad you brought that up, because going back to that question of indecisive or due diligence, I see nothing wrong with, rather than interviewing one person saying, okay, this is the guy we want, why not bring in five new guys and say, hey, look, how would you get the most out of Deshaun Watson? And just compile all of those ideas, even if you ultimately know you're not hiring any of these guys. There's nothing wrong with saying, okay, here's another outside perspective. So to answer my own question, I would say due diligence to that. But I think that's fair.
Still surprised that there wasn't a front runner in his mind, you know, like when they made the change with their defensive coordinator last year, and Jim Schwartz was the immediate front runner. And, you know, it took a week's time for him to be named. I thought they were following that path. Now, I don't know if something set it back or what, but there's a lot of coordinators making moves. Because the, you know, head coaches, it's going to be end up what, 8 head coaching changes, and only 6 of them have been filled.
Speaking of the head coaching changes, to move away from the Browns for just a second here, the latest hire, Atlanta, Raheem Morris, former head coach in the NFL. But Tony, that was the only one linked to Bill Belichick, and right now he's without a job. Not so much do you think he's going to coach this year. Do you think he's done in general now?
Well, it's hard to predict the future, but I always felt that if he didn't jump right back into coaching in 2024, at his age, he would probably not return. You know,
just kind of fade away.
Right. Or go on to TV or whatever he wants to do. Mm-hmm. I'm equally shocked that Mike Vrabel hasn't been linked, you know, as the front runner anywhere. I mean, he has had more interviews than Belichick had, and there's still two openings, Seattle and Washington. But I counted Vrabel as one of the top two candidates this whole hiring season, and doesn't seem like he's close to anything.
Yeah. All right, we have two big games on Sunday. Chiefs in Baltimore to take on the Ravens at 3 o'clock, and then 6:30, it's the NFC Championship game. The Lions in San Francisco to take on the Niners. Which game are you looking forward to most? What's the best storyline that could come out of these games? Just kind of your overall vibe for the weekend.
Oh, it's got to be Kansas City at Baltimore. Patrick Mahomes and Lamar Jackson in the biggest game of the season in the AFC. Mahomes trying to get to the Super Bowl via the road for the first time in his 6 years in the league, or 6 years as the starter. He's made six consecutive AFC championship games. And this is the first one that's not in Kansas City. And in Baltimore's case, it's their first host of the AFC. They've gotten to the Super Bowl twice via the road. So, and also the head-to-head matchup between Patrick Mahomes and Lamar Jackson, the two best quarterbacks, two of the top five probably players in the entire NFL.
Yeah.
And our personal interest in the AFC North. You know, I can't get out of my head, Chris. The Cleveland Browns went to Baltimore and beat them. The Ravens, one of the few teams. I don't care how it was done. You know, you could say Baltimore gave it away, whatever. They could beat there. They could be there right today preparing for this game. The Browns could have if they had the Houston. So that's the number one game to me. The other one, it's more sentimental. You got to be rooting for Detroit. They and the Cleveland Browns are kind of the end of the longtime NFL franchises that have never appeared in a Super Bowl. Houston and Jacksonville are the two others, but they're newly born. So I've always considered the Lions kind of the Cleveland Browns of the NFC. They once were rivals back in the 50s. And I always dreamt that if the Browns got to the Super Bowl, it would be Detroit they would face. It would only be fitting. So maybe Detroit's 1 year ahead of their time, but it's right there in front of them. I think they got a decent chance against San Francisco.
Just real quick, Tone, give me your predictions for the two games and who you think will be in the Super Bowl.
I think Baltimore wins by a field goal. I think this is going to be a shootout with the quarterback with the ball last probably wins. And both of these teams have fantastic special teams and kicking games. So I don't expect a missed field goal to decide that game. Detroit at San Francisco, I think it's a tough task for Detroit, a dome team, to travel across the country and play on the road in Santa Clara, it is, against the NFC's best team. Again, I think Detroit's year is coming. I'm not sure it's this year, although you can never guarantee them getting even back to this.
Yeah.
But I think San Francisco prevails, and I think they win their game. They beat the points. What is it, 7.5 or something?
7.5 last time I saw.
But I'll certainly be rooting for Detroit in that game. I think it's going to be a good game too. But Kansas City Baltimore game be excellent viewing.
Yeah. Yes, it will. Tone, great stuff all week. The coaching search continues. Maybe by Monday, next time we get together, we'll have an answer. If not, we'll keep our search party going here.
Yeah, you know, with the Senior Bowl coming up, that's a kind of a convention of unemployed coaches too. I don't think it stretches into the Senior Bowl week.
Yeah.
I think we'll have a coordinator, if not by the weekend, certainly early next week.
Great stuff, Tone. Enjoy the weekend. We'll talk Monday.
Very good, Chris. See you then.